Hi boys, Sohini Bala once again. I hope you have gone through the chapter A Gift of Chapels. If you have not read it thoroughly, please go through it and then come for this lesson. So let's go ahead with the second part. First part you have already done. Mridu kept up to the window. Lali was sitting a little distance away, awkwardly holding her violin and bowstring, her elbows jutting out and her eyes glazed with concentration. In front of her, with most of his back to the window, was the bony figure of the music master. He had a mostly bald head with a fringe of oiled black hair falling around his ears and an old-fashioned tuft. A gold chain gleamed around his leathery neck and a diamond ring glittered on his hand as it glided up and down the stem of the violin. A large foot stuck out from beneath his gold-bordered vesty edge and he was beating time on the floor with the scrawny big toe. Now, look at the difficult words which have appeared in this paragraph. First is glided. Glided means moved. So it moved along smoothly up and down the stem of the violin. And second one is vesti. Vesti is dhoti in Tamil. Now let's go back to the paragraph. Mridu kept up to the window. See, in the last part you read that Lalli was learning violin with the music master. The music master played violin very well, whereas Mridu kept making mistakes. Music master has been described as, you know, as a train going on the rail smoothly, but Lalli was going off the track, off the rail, every now and then. So, she made such a screeching sound that everybody was startled. Now, just to, after hearing that sound, Mridu crept up to the window. She just went up to the window to have a look inside. Lalli was sitting a distance away, awkwardly holding her violin and bowstring. Awkwardly holding her violin and bowstring, what does it show? Now, she was not holding her violin and bowstring properly, because she was a learner and she didn't know how to hold the violin in the right manner. Her elbows jutting out and her eyes glazed with concentration. She was trying to, you know, focus. Her eyes were bright with concentration, but she was not able to learn much. In front of her, with most of his back to the window, was the bony figure of the music master. In front of Lalli, the music master was sitting and music master's back was towards the window. He had a mostly bald head with a fringe of oiled black hair falling around his ears. I mean, most of his head was bald, only a fringe of hair he had around his ears and an old-fashioned tuft. Tuft, you know, in India it's called choti. A gold chain gleamed around his leathery neck. His neck has been described as leathery. Leathery means it had become hard. He was wearing a gold chain which was shining on his neck and a diamond ring glittered on his hand. He was wearing a diamond ring on his hand and it could be seen when he glided up, moved up his hand up and down the stem of the violin. When he was moving his hand up and down, his shining diamond ring could be seen. A large foot stuck out from beneath his gold bordered vesti edge. He was wearing a dhoti which had gold border, golden border, and a large foot came out from beneath the border of that dhoti, and he was beating time on the floor with the scrawny big toe. You know, he had a very, very thin and long toes. So, with his scrawny toe, he was beating time. Time means he was beating his foot on the floor just to, give the rhythm. He played a few notes. Lalli stumbled behind him on her violin, which looked quite helpless and unhappy in her hands. What a difference! The music master's notes seemed to float up and settle perfectly into the invisible tracks of the melody. It was like the wheels of a train fitting smoothly into the rails and whizzing along, as Ravi said. Mridu stared at that huge, bearinged hand moving effortlessly up the violin system, making lovely music. Let's look at the difficult words. First is stumbled. So, what is the meaning of stumbled? Followed haltingly, means not smoothly, not moving smoothly, moving haltingly, hesitatingly. Second one is bearinged. Bearinged means the music master is wearing a ring, so his hand was bearinged. Now, let's look at the paragraph. He played a few notes. Lalli stumbled behind him on her violin. Music master played a few notes and Lalli stumbled. She could not play violin smoothly. She could not follow the music master smoothly, which looked quite helpless and unhappy in her hands. What is that which is unhappy in her hands? That is the violin. I mean, the violin looked helpless and unhappy in her hands. It shows, the expression shows that she was not holding it properly. Because she was a learner, she didn't know how to hold it properly. What a difference. The music master's note seems to float up and settle perfectly into the invisible tracks of the melody. So, the whole expression shows that the music master was very good at playing violin. His notes seemed to float up and settle perfectly into the invisible tracks of the melody. Means, his notes were falling at the right place or in the right tune. But, on the other hand, Lalli was not able to play at all. It was like the wheels of a train fitting smoothly into the rails. You know, music master's playing violin was like wheels of a train. Wheels of a train, if they fit smoothly into the rails and whizzing along, as Ravi said, and whizzing along, making sound, that is rhythmic sound, perfect sound. So, music master was a very good teacher, whereas Lalli was not able to follow him correctly. Mridu stared at that huge, bearinged hand moving effortlessly up the violin system, making lovely music. Mridu kept looking at that hand of music master, which had rings, and this hand was moving effortlessly, means very, very smoothly, up the violin system, making lovely music. Music master was playing violin very, very, smoothly, and his hand was moving effortlessly, as if, you know, he was so used to it, and he was producing very beautiful music. Next paragraph. Squack. There was Lalli derailing again. You know, Lalli's sound of violin was unpleasant. Once again, she had derailed. She had gone off the track. Amma came a wail from the gate. Amma, Ravi, send that beggar away, cried his mother from the back veranda, where she was chatting with Tapi. He has been coming here every day for the past week, and it's time he found another house to beg from, Pati explained to Tapi. Now, there was a sound, there was a voice. Amma, this voice came from the gate. Amma, now, Ravi, send that beggar away, cried his mother from the back veranda. Now, whose voice was it? This Amma was the voice of the beggar. There was a beggar at the gate, and Pati, mother, Ravi's mother said, Ravi, send that beggar away. He has been coming here every day for past 1 week, and it's time he found another house to beg from. He should not come here. Pati explained to Tapi. Mridu and Meena followed Ravi out. The beggar was already in the garden, making himself quiet at home. He had spread his upper cloth under the neem tree and was leaning against its trunk, apparently prepared to take a little snooze while he waited for the arms to appear. "Go away," said Ravi sternly. "My Pati says it's time you found another house to beg from." Difficult word is, new word is snooze, and the meaning of snooze, short sleep. Mridu and Meena followed Ravi out. Ravi was going out, Mridu and Meena also followed. The beggar was already in the garden, making himself quiet at home. Quiet at home, making himself comfortable. He had spread his upper cloth under the neem tree. The cloth he was wearing, he had put that under the tree, under the neem tree, and was leaning against its trunk, apparently prepared to take a little nap while he waited for the arms to appear. While he was waiting for something from the house, he was making himself comfortable and he thought of taking a nap for a while. "Go away," said Ravi sternly. Sternly, strictly. Ravi said very strictly to the beggar to go away. "My Pati says it's time you found another house to beg from." So Ravi repeated what Pati said. Pati said send that beggar away. So Ravi also repeated the same thing, and he said, "It's time for you to find another house to beg from." Now let's go to the next paragraph. The beggar opened his eyes very wide and gazed at each of the children one by one. "The ladies of this house," he said at last in a voice choked with feeling, "are very kind souls. I have kept my body and soul together on their generosity for a whole week. I cannot believe that they would turn me away." He raised his voice. "Amma, Amma, oh," said his wail might be. Sad his wail might be, but it certainly wasn't feeble. It began in a deep, strong rumble somewhere in his withered belly and came booming out of his mouth with its few remaining teeth stained brown with beetle chewing. So this expression, "kept my body and soul together," means managed to stay alive, kept myself alive. Let's look at the paragraph. The beggar opened his eyes very wide and gazed at each of the children one by one. He opened his eyes wide because he was slightly shocked. Shocked at what Ravi had said, that "my Pati says, go away, look for some other house." And then he started saying, at last he said in a voice choked with feeling, you know, he was emotional, and with emotions in his voice, he said, "The ladies of this house are very kind souls. They are very generous. I have kept my body and soul together on their generosity for a whole week." I have kept, that means I have kept myself alive on their kindness for a whole week. That means they had been taking care of this beggar for a week. Now he says, "I cannot believe that they would turn me away." It was unbelievable for the beggar that these ladies would turn him away, would send him away. He raised his voice. "Amma, Amma, oh," sad his wail might be. He's crying, speaking was very sad, but it was certainly not, wasn't feeble. Feeble means weak. His voice was not weak. It was sad. It began in a deep, strong rumble somewhere in his withered belly. It seems as if the sound began from his withered belly, you know, hungry stomach, and then came booming out of his mouth. Then came, you know, loudly through his mouth with its few remaining teeth stained brown, through his teeth which were stained, which were colored brown because of beetle chewing. Beetle chewing, that palm leaf. So he spoke not in a weak voice. It was quite strong, but the voice was very sad, and he had explained that he expected a lot from this house because the ladies of this house were very generous, very kind, and he kept himself alive for a week, but this he never expected. Let's read the next paragraph. Ravi, tell him there is nothing left in the kitchen, called Rukumani, and he is not to come again. Tell him that. She sounded fed up. Fed up means tired and unhappy. So Rukumani told Ravi to tell the beggar to go away and not to come again. And she said there was nothing left in the kitchen. She sounded fed up. She sounded frustrated now, that enough is enough now. Ravi didn't have to repeat it all to the beggar. What his mother said had been easy for them all to hear, there under the neem tree. The beggar sat up and sighed. See, Ravi didn't have to repeat what the beggar said. Why? Because it was audible to everybody. When it was audible to everybody, it was audible to the beggar also. He could also understand. He was sitting under the neem tree, and they were also under the neem tree. So the beggar heard it, and he sat up and sighed. Sighed, took a deep breath. I'll go, he said wearily. Only let me have a rest here under this tree. The sun is so hot. The tar has melted on the road. My feet are already blistered. He stretched out his feet to show large pink peeling blisters on the soles of his bare feet. So, blisters means boils or bubbles on the skin from burns or rubbing. He said, I'll go. He was tired. He looked tired. Only let me have a rest here under this neem tree. The sun is so hot. The tar has melted on the road. Tar, that charcoal which is spread on the road. The tar has melted. My feet are already blistered. My feet already have boils. He stretched out his feet to show large pink peeling blisters on the soles of his bare feet. He stretched out his legs, his feet, to show blisters on his feet. I suppose he doesn't have the money to buy chappals, Mridu whispered to Meenal. Ravi, have you got an old pair in the house somewhere? She said, when Mridu looked at his, you know, peeling blisters, she said, I suppose he doesn't have money to buy chappals. Now, Meena, Ravi, do you have any pair of chappals in the house? Some extra chappals anywhere in the house? She asked. I don't know, said Ravi. Mine are too small to fit his feet, or I would have given them to him. And his feet were larger than Mridu's and Meena's. So Ravi said, I don't know if there are any pair of chappals. My chappals are too small, and his feet were larger than Mridu's and Meena's feet. So our chappals would not fit him. The beggar was shaking out his upper cloth and tightening his dhoti. He raised his eyes and looked fearfully at the road, gleaming in the afternoon heat. So, see, the beggar was shaking out his upper cloth, the one which he had spread under the neem tree to sit, and tightening his dhoti. Why was he, he raised his eyes and looked fearfully at the road. What was he afraid of? Why did he look at the road fearfully? Because it was too hot and the road was almost burning with heat, gleaming in the afternoon heat, because the this charcoal had melted and he did not have chappals. So he was just scared how he would walk in that afternoon. He needs something on his feet, Meena said, her big eyes filling. It's not fair. He needs something on his feet. Now Meena's eyes were filling. Filling with what? Filling with tears. She had lot of pity on the poor beggar, and she said, it's not fair, it's not fair, it's not okay that we let him go like this. Eyes filling with tears. Yeah. Now next. Shh, said Ravi, I'm thinking about it. Blubbering, it's not fair, it's not fair, isn't going to help. In 2 minutes he'll be frying his feet on that road. What he needs is a pair of chappals. So where do we get them? Come, let's search the house. He pushed Mridu and Meena into the house. Ravi said that he was also thinking about it. And he went on saying, blubbering, mumbling to himself, it's not fair, it's not fair, it's not going to help. Like, why he was also feeling bad about the beggar. And he said, in 2 minutes he will be frying his feet on that road. If he goes out, what will be the condition? He will fry his feet. So what he needs is a pair of chappals. So where do we get them from? Come, let's search the house. And he took Mridu and Meena into the house. Just as she stepped into the veranda, Mridu's eyes fell on the odd-looking chappals she had noticed when she arrived. Ravi, she whispered to him, whose are those? As Mridu had seen one pair of chappals when she kept her own chappals when she entered the house, she saw those chappals, noticed those chappals right now, and she said, Ravi, whose are those? Those chappals were still there. Ravi turned and glanced at the shabby looking but sturdy old slippers. He beamed and nodded. These are just the right size, he said, picking them up. Mridu and Meena followed him nervously back into the garden. So Ravi turned and glanced at the shabby looking but sturdy old chappals. These chappals looked very shabby because they were very dusty. They looked grey. But they were sturdy, strong, and old. He beamed and nodded. He felt very happy. And he said, no, he nodded as if he had found something. He had found a treasure. These are just the right size, he said, picking them up. He just picked up those chappals and he said, these are just the right size. Mridu and Meena followed him nervously into the garden. Why were they nervous? Because they were picking somebody's chappals without any permission. Let's read further. Here, said Ravi to the beggar, dropping the slippers in front of the old man. Wear these and don't come back. The beggar stared at the slippers, hurriedly flung his towel over his shoulder, pushed his feet into them and left, muttering a blessing to the children. In a minute, he had vanished around the corner of the street. So the beggar, Ravi said to the beggar, here. He dropped the chappals, the slippers in front of the beggar, and he said, wear these and don't come back. The beggar understood. He very quickly he put the chappals on. He put flung his towel over his shoulder and pushed his feet into the slippers and muttering a blessing to the children. God bless you, children. And in a minute he vanished, disappeared around the corner of the street. He just went away. Go ahead. The music master came out of the house and took an unappreciative look at the three of them sitting quietly under the tree, playing marbles. Then he searched for his chappals in the veranda where he had put them. The music master, after the lesson, came out of the house and took an unappreciative look. Unappreciative? Disapproving, not appreciating them. He looked at three of them sitting quietly under the tree and playing marbles. And then he searched for his chappals in the veranda where he had put them. He started searching for the chappals, which were not to be seen anywhere. Lalli, he called after a few moments. She hurried up to him. Have you seen my chappals, my dear? I remember having kept them here. He inquired Lalli if she had seen his chappals anywhere. Ravi, Mridu and Meena silently watched Lalli and the music master search every corner of the veranda. He scurried around, looking over the railing and crouching near the flower pots to look between them. Brand new they were. I went all the way to Mount Road to buy them. He went on saying, they cost a whole month's fees. Do you know? So the music master was frantically looking for the chappals here and there. Ravi, Mridu and Meena were silently watching Lalli and music master search every corner of the veranda. He scurried around, he ran around, looking over the railing and crouching near the flower pot, bending down, looking under the flower pots to look between them. And he said, brand new they were. I went all the way to Mount Road to buy them. I mean, now he started talking very high of his chapel since they were not there. He went on saying, they cost a whole month's fees, do you know? So he emphasized on the cost of chapel since he had lost them. Soon Lalli went in to tell her mother. Rukumani appeared, looking harassed, with Pati following her. So very soon Lalli went inside to tell her mother about the lost chappals. Rukumani came, she appeared looking harassed, troubled, with Pati following her. Pati also came. Where could they be? It's really quite upsetting to think someone might have stolen them. So many vendors come to the door, worried Pati. Pati got worried that how could the chappals disappear from there? So many people keep coming. She just wondered if anybody had stolen those chappals from the veranda. Rukumani caught sight of Ravi, Mridu and Meena sitting under the tree. Have you children? She began, and then seeing they were curiously quiet, went on more seriously, more slowly. Seen anyone lurking around the veranda? A sharp V-shaped line had formed between her eyebrows. Another straight, tighter one appeared in place of her usually soft, pleasant mouth. Rukumani was angry, thought Mridu with a shiver. She wouldn't be so upset if she knew about the poor beggar with sores on his feet, she tried to tell herself. Now, what's the difficult word? Lurking. Lurking means waiting quietly without attracting attention. Now, let's come back to the paragraph. Rukmani caught sight of Ravi, Mirdu and Meena sitting under the tree. These three were sitting under the tree and they were very, very quiet, unusually quiet. She started asking, "Have you children?" And then she went more slowly. Then she asked, probably she changed her question, "Have you children seen anyone lurking around the veranda?" Means moving around quietly around the veranda. A sharp V-shaped line had formed between her eyebrows. So what does it show? That there was tension, there was stress that could be seen on her forehead. Another straight, tighter one appeared in place of her usually soft, pleasant mouth. Another line appeared. She was usually pleasant looking woman, but this line of anger was formed on her face, and Rukmani was angry, it was clear, thought Mridu with a shiver. She started she had a tremble because she was scared that Rukmani was angry. She wouldn't be so upset if she knew about the poor beggar. With sores on his feet, she tried to tell herself. You know, in order to convince herself of her act, of their act, which they had done jointly, she started thinking of the poor beggar. And she thought, to justify her action, she thought that Rukmani would not be upset if she knows about poor beggar's condition. Condition of his feet, which had pink peeling blisters. We go ahead. Taking a deep breath, she cried, "Rukmani, there was a beggar here. Poor thing. He had such boils on his feet." "So," said Rukmani grimly, turning to Ravi, "you gave the music master's chapels to that old beggar who turns up here?" Now, taking a deep breath, she cried, "Rukmani, there was a beggar here, poor thing, he had such boils on his feet." So, said Rukmani grimly, turning to Ravi, "you gave the music master's chapels to that old beggar who turns up here?" Children these days, grown Pati. Now, "Amma, didn't you tell me about Karna who gave away everything he had, even his gold earrings? He was so kind and generous." "You know, silly," snapped Rukmani. "Karna didn't give away other people's things. He only gave away his own." See, here the mention of Karna from Mahabharata is being made. Karna gave everything. He gave everything, whatever he had, even his earrings, kundals. That's a famous story. But she says, Rukmani says, that Karna didn't give others things. He gave his own things, not other people's things, without their permission. "But my chappals wouldn't have fitted the beggar's feet," Ravi rushed brashly on. "And Amma, if they did fit, would you really not have minded?" Now, Ravi said that my chappals would not have fitted beggar's feet. "And Amma, if they did fit, would you really not have minded if I had given my chappals?" "Ravi," said Rukmani, very angry now, "go inside this minute." She hurried indoors and brought out Gopu Mama's hardly worn new chappals. "These should fit you, sir. Please put these on. I'm so sorry. My son has been very naughty." The music master's eyes lit up. He put them on, trying not to look so happy. look too happy. Well, I suppose these will have to do. These days children have no respect for elders. What to do? A Hanuman incarnate. Only Rama can save such a naughty fellow. Rukmani's eyes flashed. She didn't seem to like Ravi being called a monkey, even a holy monkey. She stood stiff and straight by the front door. It was clear she wanted him to leave quickly. So Ravi said, Rukmani, very angry now, go inside this minute. Rukmani asked Ravi to go inside. She hurried indoors. She went inside the house and brought out Gopu Mama's hardly worn new chappals. Gopu Mama had hardly worn those chappals. He brought those chappals for the music master and she said, these should fit you, sir. Please put these on. You can take these chappals. I am so sorry. My son has been very naughty. The music master's eyes lit up. He put them on, trying not to look too happy. Why was he so happy? Because he had got a new pair of chappals. Well, I suppose these will have to, these will do. I will take these chappals. These days children have no respect for elders. What to do? He said, a Hanuman incarnate. I mean, your son is, incarnation of Hanuman. And that is a monkey. Only Rama can save such a naughty fellow. Rukmani's eyes flashed. She didn't like. She had a little anger in her eyes. She didn't seem to like Ravi being called a monkey. Even if he was called being called a Hanuman, still she didn't like. Even a holy monkey. She stood stiff and straight by the front door. She didn't give any reaction. It was clear she wanted him to leave quickly. When he had cluttered off in his new chappals, she said, Mridu, come in and have some tiffin. Honestly, how do you children think of such things? Thank God your Gopu Mama doesn't wear his chappals to work. As she walked towards the kitchen with Mridu and Meena, she suddenly began to laugh. But he is always in such a hurry to throw off his shoes and socks and get into his chappals as soon as he comes home. What is your mama going to say this evening when I tell him I gave his chappals to the music master? When the music master had cluttered off, he had moved away noisily wearing those chappals, she said to Mridu, come in and have some tiffin. Honestly, how do you children think of such things? How do you get such ideas? Thank God your Gopu Mama doesn't wear chappals to work. Otherwise, there would have been no chappals to give to music master. As she walked toward the kitchen with Mridu and Meena, she suddenly began to laugh. It was a mysterious laugh, nobody could understand, and she was just thinking, she said, he's always in such a hurry to throw off his shoes and socks and get into his chappals as soon as he comes home. She started thinking of Gopu Mama, who always was in a hurry to put on his chappal the moment he came home. What is your mama going to say this evening when I tell him I gave his chappals to the music master? And she smiled to herself. Clattered off. Gone off noisily with the noise or clatter of chappals. And this is the comprehension check based on these, the second part of the story. Let's just go through. The music master is making lovely music. Read aloud the sentence in the text that expresses this idea. I think you can find this. You can find this sentence. The sentence that expresses the idea. The music master goes, goes on continuously, the sentence you have to lift from the book, that he plays lovely music, the expression of Ravi. And second one, had the beggar come to Rukmani's house for the first time, give reasons for your answer. What do you think? The beggar had not come to Rukmani's house for the first time. There are reasons, because Rukmani said, tell that beggar to look for some other house for begging. And even the beggar said that ladies of this house are very kind souls. I have been keeping my body and soul together for a week due to generosity of the ladies of this house. So these are the reasons which you can give. Third one, a sharp V-shaped line had formed between her eyebrows. What does it suggest to you about Rukmani? It suggests that Rukmani was angry now, and that is the part end of part 2. In the next chapter, in the next lesson rather, we would do all the question answers and exercises. By till then, if you don't understand, go through it again, read it once again, and then come for the next part. Bye. Thank you.